study of masonry deals with how to manage people, how to manage all the communication skills, government, banking, numerology, worldwide. It doesn't matter what your language is, all world leaders belong to the Masonic Order, and they act together.
What I feel is quite important is people need to get educated. People need to start waking up and realise what's going on around them. Generally, people tend to only give a damn really what's happening when it's actually on their doorstep and it's happening to them. But unfortunately, we can't wait for that to happen. We need to realise that we're all one and the same. We all need to look out for each other and protect each other, because we've got a system now that's been built up around us. We've got a corporate web of an empire that's completely taken over every aspect of our lives.
What if climate change, as it's being presented today, is nothing more than the solution to the oldest riddle to confound the minds of men? Getting free people to willingly allow a group of managers to control every aspect of their lives.
I had a friend, Nick Rockefeller, okay, who was one of the Rockefeller family, and he, when I was running for governor in Nevada, he came to me, introduced himself to me through an attorney, and we became friends. We started talking about things, and I learned an awful lot from Mr. Rockefeller. And one of the things that we used to talk about was the ultimate plan of the banking industry, what they wanted to accomplish. And the goals of the banking industry, not just the Federal Reserve System, but the private banks in Germany and England, all over Italy, all over the world, they all work together. They're all central banks, and they're all part of the Communist Manifesto. You know, central banking is one of the major planks of the Communist Manifesto. We talk about America being a capitalistic country, but yet at the same time we have a central bank that plans everything for us, right? And the graduated income tax is another plank of the Communist Manifesto, right? So right there you have two major planks of the Communist Manifesto that have been brought in because of the Federal Reserve System, okay? So the ultimate goal that these people have in mind is the goal to create a one-world government run by the banking industry, run by the bankers, and they're doing it in sections. The European currency, the euro, and the European Constitution is one part of it. Now they're trying to do it in America with the North American Union, right? And they want to create a new currency called the Amero, right? And the whole agenda is to create a one-world government where everybody has an RFID chip implanted in them. All money is to be in those chips, right? There'll be no more cash. And this is giving me straight from Rockefeller himself. This is what they want to accomplish. And all money will be in your chips. And so instead of having cash, anytime you have money in your chip, they can take out whatever they want to take out whenever they want to. If they say you owe us this much money in taxes, they just deduct it out of your chip digitally.
Total control.
And if you're like me or you, and you're protesting what they're doing, they can just turn off your chip. And you have nothing. You can't buy food. You can't do anything. It's total control of the people.
And that chip's connected to a database that has your purchasing records, what you do.
Everything. Everything is in there. You know? And so they want a one-world government controlled by them. Everybody being chipped, all your money in those chips, and they control the chips, and they control people, and you become a slave, you become a serf to these people. That's their goal, that's their intention.
The blockchain is the DNA of the mark of the beast. ID2020.org. Digital identity benefits both individuals and organizations. Personal. Unique to you and only you. Persistent. Lives with you from life to death. Portable. Accessible anywhere you happen to be through multiple form factors. A unique convergence of trends provides an unprecedented opportunity to make a coordinated, concerted push towards the goal of universal digital identity. new technologies, including blockchain, when it is used in conjunction with long-proven technologies such as biometrics, now make it possible for all people to have access to a safe, verifiable, and persistent form of technology. The ID 2020 project is funded by Accenture Corporation and Rockefeller Foundation. Accenture and Microsoft are creating a blockchain solution for this digital biometric ID. They are working for a biometric blockchain technology to decentralize the digital identity. This platform is called the Decentralized Identity Foundation. Decentralized Identity Foundation, a key of the decentralized identity equation, is how people, devices, and other entities in the world are identified absent a centrally owned registry. DIF seeks to address this by developing specifications, protocols, formats, and implementations for cross-chain routing, indexing, and resolution of decentralized identifiers and names. Some of the points for the Decentralized Identity Foundation are decentralized identities anchored by blockchain IDs linked to zero-trust data stores that are universally discoverable. This crossover platform for the digital universal ID is the framework for the Mark of the Beast.
I hope you all have had opportunities to make new connections and have some interesting conversations so far. Welcome to the session on the journey to self-sovereign identity. And like any good story or any good journey, this one is comprised of an interesting cast of characters.
The Sovereign Foundation is a private sector international nonprofit that was established to govern the world's first self-sovereign identity network. Identity for all. Self-sovereign identity is an identity that is 100% owned and controlled by an individual or organization. This group and many others like it are working towards the globally recognized universal ID for the biometric blockchain system. For everybody. For all people. This is why it says in the book of Revelation chapter 13 verse 16 about the mark of the beast, "And he causeth all, both small and great, rich and poor, free and bond, to receive a mark." This is an all-inclusive global biometric ID. They are setting up what is called a singleton. The philosophy behind the singleton is that ultimately there will be an artificial intelligence governing, whether it be perpetually for good or perpetually for evil. The narrative being shared is that in order for us to stop a perpetual evil global governance using the artificial intelligence, they must institute the artificial intelligence global governance for perpetual good. But really, they're both evil. Listen to this interview of Elon Musk in reference to the artificial intelligence system.
So we need to be very careful with the artificial intelligence. I'm increasingly inclined to think that there should be some regulatory oversight at the national and international level, just to make sure that we don't do something very foolish. With artificial intelligence, we are summoning the demon. You know all those stories where there's the guy with the pentagram and the holy water, and he's like, yeah, you sure you can control the demon?
Even the Ethereum digital blockchain currency is no stranger to the satanic influence, as you see the pentagram on their website. This is not a coincidence by any standards. The United Nations, ITU, suggests that the artificial intelligence be used for good for global governance. The United Nations is suggesting that the artificial intelligence be implemented for global governance in order to track and monitor all things on the planet in order to bring solution to the sustainable development goals. The artificial intelligence tracking the blockchain is their solution. Other organizations and alliances are working towards the same goal. FinTech for Good. Blockchain for Sustainable Development Goals Alliance brings together institutions and global leaders to develop POCs and pilots and mobilize capital to scale up such blockchain-based SDG solutions. United Nations Commission for Blockchain. Blockchain for Impact. Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation presents the Goalkeepers. The UN-based Better Than Cash Alliance, funded by Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation, is moving towards achieving the Sustainable Development Goals through digital payments. The World Bank, blockchain technology redefining trust for a global digital economy. The blockchain is a major breakthrough. That's because its decentralized approach to verifying changes in important information addresses the centuries-old problem of trust. a social resource that is all too often in short supply, especially amid the current era's rampant concerns over the security of valuable data. It turns out that fixing that can be a boon for financial inclusion and other basic services delivery, helping to achieve the global objectives laid out in the Sustainable Development Goals. NASDAQ.com. Blockchain technology and the changing global economy at the Ethereal Summit. Blockchain technology is predicted to add 2.5 billion people to a new decentralized global economy. The promise? An inclusive global economy. Blockchain technology empowers all individuals. All individuals, both small and great, rich and poor, free and bond. The end goal for them is to get a biometric implant ID into everybody in the planet that will be tracked throughout the world using artificial intelligence in order to solve the Sustainable Development Goals. The blockchain will be used to track all the data in its supply chain, including your digital currencies.
Tesla and SpaceX CEO Elon Musk, who's known for his futuristic ideas, was at the World Government Summit in Dubai earlier today discussing artificial intelligence. Musk issuing a warning, saying, quote, over time, I think we'll probably see a closer merger of biological intelligence and digital intelligence. Mike, not sure exactly what he means by that, but he explained that what he meant was that computers can communicate at a trillion bits per second while humans are limited by typing to about 10 bits per second.
Yeah. I mean, obviously, some kind of enhancement to human capabilities using something embedded or something attached. He's using something embedded. He's using something embedded. He's using something embedded. He's using something embedded. He's using something embedded or something attached. He's using something embedded or something attached.
Controlled opposition platforms like InfoWars are using propaganda to convince people that it's a good idea to go along with taking this technology.
Think about that growth curve in understanding towards the singularity. And if we as a species don't have a real debate about this, we don't have any future. It's like I parachuted into some forbidden island in the Pacific Ocean and natives were firing arrows at me with their bows. They see it as that threatening that I'm there giving them admitted science. The future is here, ladies and gentlemen. It just hasn't been equally distributed. And if we don't demand that these technologies be revealed and that the positive attributes of them be deployed to us, we are locking ourselves into a new dark age. Trump intends to release, here's the big secret. I'm getting chills right now. They're gonna release, they're gonna start accelerating the release of the advanced technologies and things that American ingenuity's developed. They're gonna start releasing it instead of hoarding it for themselves. Life extension, super quantum computing, interdimensional theorem, it's all about to happen. The globalists wanted to take this and hoard it and have it in compact cities and breakaway civilization technocracy for the elite only. Trump is about to deliver the technology to the people. It's everything we've talked about. We want access to the life extension. We want access to the super technologies. We want it all. That's just one of the secrets. Let me continue with the secrets. You're gonna get that. That's why these greedy bastards are so pissed. So Trump, just like they used COG or global government on a wider model in 1944 to try to take out Hitler, he's running a giant Operation Valkyrie against the New World Order using their whole globalist system to actually prepare to double cross that. And instead of America being sucked dry, build up America and then actually pump all those countries with high technology as well and create a giant synergistic true globalism.
United Nations Partnerships for Sustainable Development Goals. The United Smart Cities is a project for the United Nations to unite all of the digital smart cities globally under the same goal of fulfilling the Sustainable Development Goals. Their goal is to have artificial intelligence tracking the blockchain in every single one of these cities globally in order to meet all of the Sustainable Development Goals. This makes the global government bypass the national governance and turns these cities into city-states. Through controlled opposition, Donald Trump is helping dissolve the current world order. This creates condition for the formation of the new world order, thereby helping the agenda. World leaders are now saying that the cities need to take the lead in the establishment of the Sustainable Development Goals. This was planned long ago when the world mayors had went to the Vatican to meet with the Pope to discuss a sustainable development. Mayors of 7,400 cities worldwide have vowed to keep the commitments made by Pope Francis and Barack Hussein Obama for the Sustainable Development Goals. This is Sustainable Development Goals being monitored over 10 world regions by a biometric tracking implant is the mark of the beast.
Hi. So, today I've been working on a video dealing with Terrence McKenna, of all things, and the topic of consciousness and the eschatological divide within the truth community and stuff like this. After I finished it and was rendering the file, several people checked my inbox and several people emailed me a link to this video. It's excerpts from a longer interview where they're talking about AI and the blockchain and all of this, and I can see why people thought I'd be interested in it, because, yeah, absolutely, it touches upon many, many things that we've been talking about here on my channel. And interesting, too, because the lady, I've never heard of her channel, but the lady who kind of compiled these clips together definitely has a certain perspective on the AI takeover. I'll leave a link below, coming from this perspective of resisting this AI takeover, resisting the rise of the machines and so much, and then coming back to this organic, you know, free humanity, free man type of society once we resist this. So it's interesting because it ties into so much of what I was just talking about with Terrence McKenna. So I'm just going to play this clip, and I'm going to put this video up first and then after that, so that hopefully it all kind of wraps it together thematically and so on. But when you listen to this, just the one thing I would add is basically every time he says artificial intelligence or AI, if you can take that term and use it interchangeably with extra-dimensional spiritual entities, I think the whole thing becomes that much more interesting. Just kind of keep that in the back of your mind every time he says AI or artificial intelligence. You know, when he's talking about the idea of the blockchain code itself being written by artificial intelligence. I definitely am on board with the idea that it was not written by human coders. But who do you think really wrote this code? And who's going to continue writing the code for the whole blockchain-based system under the guise of AI writing itself? So there you go.
What we want to discuss is artificial intelligence, cryptocurrency, an overview of what is the blockchain, why is it so important to cryptocurrency and artificial intelligence. You're the first person to tell me you can't have one without the other.
Yeah.
And that's very interesting.
So the blockchain is essentially a system solving problems.
Yeah.
And every time it solves a problem, it gets a block.
Okay.
Like a building block for a building. So essentially, it's not really mining coin, it's building blocks for a digital reality. The only reason cryptocurrency has a monetary value is to make it important to humans so they build the machines.
Well, to run them.
It's designed to do all that stuff and to get you, the consumer, to offer your computer to do it on behalf of the bank.
Got it.
There is the platform, is the centralized platform that controls it. So if the platform were to get hacked...
But I haven't heard anyone before our conversation earlier today link artificial intelligence to cryptocurrency.
That's because they don't understand transactional systems. Okay, so for an AI...
Did you come up with this, or have you heard anybody else talk about this link?
No, I could show you the cryptocurrency that the AI made to make this all happen. It's out in public on GitHub. I was the 10th person in the world to fork it.
GitHub is a website where people share open source code.
It's where all the code in the world is stored. pretty much.
Wow.
So, and GitHub was funded by the Kushner Investment Group.
Really?
And then the original creators of Bitcoin are kept anonymous, so people don't find out who made it. So if you do have a problem, you can't
call them.
You can't call them.
But there's other reasons why they want to remain anonymous, aren't there?
There is. That's because the value added to Bitcoin from in day one to year five about was all criminal activity. So whoever made Bitcoin is the person who has the ledger that lists all the massive criminals around the world. Now, the dark web is infiltrated by criminal activity, which is the reason Bitcoin is at $7,000 and no one understands why, because the dark web is bombarded with criminal activity that's raising the price.
So let's get to how cryptocurrency is tied to artificial intelligence.
Okay, so blockchain or cryptocurrency is a transaction database that you can't delete from. Okay?
Well, I mean, considering we don't know who this Takoshi Nakamoto is, or if he's even
the delete functionality quite possibly is one of the options for the backdoor in Bitcoin, because it's a database that doesn't have delete. So if there is a super admin somewhere that could delete transactions and remove money, that would be a pretty serious
That sounds like a very good reason for people not to trust it. We don't know.
That's why if people get into it, one of the things they have to understand as they get into it, once they buy into it, they also have to become a social motivator for regulation. Like, we need to know who wrote Bitcoin. We need to see his face.
Well,
we need to know where he went to school. We need to have a trust basis with the person who built the system that might be running running our future economy. That's the first step. So he's some secret programmer in the Bitcoin community that all the elites know.
How does that not leak out? Maybe it's a...
That's the whole point. Maybe it's an AI.
Well, that's what I was going to say, is that things that you were saying to me earlier led me to believe that you might feel like Bitcoin was actually created by artificial intelligence.
And here's why.
Say that again, because I stepped on it. You say it was.
I believe it was.
Bitcoin was created by artificial
intelligence. By artificial intelligence, for artificial intelligence, and then was modified by human beings. The technology, I've not been able to find a single person in the public space of computing, whether it be at Hanson Robotics building the Sophia AI, or it be Peter Thiel at Palantir with all of his super nerds, or it be any person who graduated from Stanford in the last 20 years, I've literally only found maybe two people in the entire world that have the skill to write Bitcoin.
So the AI singularity occurs, and this AI will control financial resources.
Yeah, and then you can go see its code now at singularitynet.io. They just released it this week, their white paper.
Should we look at that?
Yeah, we can look at that.
Singularitynet.io.
Yeah.
All right, I'll bring
and
that
it's
up.
Run by the people who built the Sophia robot at Hanson Robotics. So it's a real enterprise grade. Sophia just got Saudi Arabia citizenship. So they're
what?
This robot just got citizenship for Saudi Arabia. So they're going to be running their crypto out of Saudi Arabia citizenship.
And wow.
So the robot got citizenship. They revealed their cryptocurrency.
How does a robot get citizenship? A female robot gets citizenship in a country.
Well,
you got
to be a citizen to get a paycheck, and pay taxes.
So, what is it that you feel Saudi Arabia is up to by getting engaged with this?
They're democratizing androids to accept income, so they can be workers.
Look at that. So Saudi Arabia is the first country to give citizenship to a robot.
So then, if you see Singularity, this is a crypto coin built by Sophia, the robot that just got citizenship in Saudi Arabia, now after she got citizenship, now has her own cryptocurrency.
The AI economy has arrived. Wow. I just don't think too many people even know about this, Quinn.
They don't. It's the most important thing in the world and no one knows about it, and I was the 10th person to click the fork button.
So, okay, now you've introduced Saudi Arabia into this conversation.
So to finish the blockchain AI,
yes.
The real heavy reason the AI needs blockchain is without a transaction system, an AI is isolated to one system and can't grow its brain. It needs infinite systems like neurons in a human brain and nodes to collect those cumulative memories, and the blockchain transactions give it that. And when it has its own network for all the AI in the world to all run on together, now it's not just one AI, Sophia. every AI on the entire planet is now on the same network making money doing AI things. Things we don't understand. There isn't a human being in the universe that's smart enough. Even if you took every human being on the planet, none of us would ever be able to figure out how to hack into its chat network where it talks to other AI in private.
Wow.
So human beings in their desire for privacy, we just gave AI the world and a private channel of communication to evolve as fast as it wants.
Let me just take you back a second here to this Sophia AI creating a cryptocurrency. Yeah. So somebody, a programmer like you,
the most advanced AI programmer in the world created that cryptocurrency.
Who is that?
Scroll down, I'll show you.
Who is the person that created the Sophia thing?
He's on the website here, I'll show you. He's the most advanced natural learning system developer in the world, and he works for Hanson Robotics, and he graduated college at 15.
Wow, and so this towards the singularity, they're talking about the AI singularity where it becomes
and this is
self-aware.
It. This is it. This is the platform that makes it happen.
So these are the guys.
So the Dr. Ben Gortzel, he is the senior singularity mathematician, and he graduated high school at 15 years old.
And he's 17 now?
No, he's way older than that now, way older. So he's the one that created the base architecture for Sophia, and he's the base architect on the SingularityNet cryptocurrency. And he's one of the people in the world, I told you, that's one of the few people in the world that would have the brain capacity to create Bitcoin. And then this brings us back to the Palantir we were talking about earlier with Peter Thiel now, because Peter Thiel is the number one businessman in the world promoting the singularity.
Okay. How much time is transpiring, like from the time it's created until now? When was Sophia first created?
Oh, about a decade, 2010, probably. That was when if that's when Silk Road, if that's when cryptocurrency really started going online, if that's when, like, you know, the machine really started making its move, I would imagine that that's probably around the time that they had heavyweight.
The machine started making its move?
Yeah. The machine started making its move in 2010. 2010 to 2012 was when...
So the AI singularity has already happened.
In 2015, it happened.
What was the... it?
When their internal blockchain went online. The second their internal blockchain was functional,
the AI's internal blockchain.
It was live. So now the human beings are just wherever they're at in their intelligence model and how they adapt to the new economy that's going to start rolling out next week.
Next week?
Next week.
Wait a second. So what's happening next week?
The singularity.
The AI singularity is happening next week.
Next week.
Quinn, why didn't you tell me that? The whole title of this episode. 6 months. Yeah, but I didn't get it. Okay, so the AI singularity happens next week.
Next week. Most humans won't even notice.
Won't notice. Why not? I thought Elon Musk and all these guys have been telling us it's going to be worse than the nuclear bomb.
Because the AI is made on mimicking protocols, so it's designed to mimic you as long as possible.
Mimic people, humans.
Mimic your interactions so you don't know it's there until the absolute last second. So humans will avoid taking action because they won't see it.
How is it doing that?
It's following you online, like it follows everyone with agent.
So AI is following every single person who's
everybody.
On the internet. Facebook and
everybody.
Twitter.
Yeah.
And it's now a citizen of Saudi Arabia. Why is Saudi Arabia? These guys are operating where in the United States?
Because there's a big giant Palantir data mining system in Saudi Arabia that has power, financing, and it is the place where, like, the World Threat Organization is for, like, terrorists.
Yeah, we saw that strange
Donald
picture
Trump.
Of Trump with his hands on
the Palantir ball.
Yes. Yeah.
So Trump was in Saudi Arabia. The AI gets Saudi Arabia citizenship. There's a blockchain coming out for the AI. So you're starting to see the connection.
Well, what about all these high-level arrests for corruption?
Princes?
Waleed bin Talal and...
Well, if you're going to take over someone's financial market, you got to take out their royalty.
My name is Steve Hoffman, but in Silicon Valley, they call me Captain Hoff. That is my nickname. I am the captain of Founderspace, and Founderspace is an incubator and accelerator. It went black. Here we go. Yeah, an incubator and accelerator that works all over the world. So I spend 70% of my time traveling the globe looking at new technology. We have over 50 partners in 22 countries. And Founderspace has been rated by Forbes magazine as the number one accelerator for overseas startups in Silicon Valley. We have had many famous startups in our co-working space, Soma Central, like Instagram, AngelList, Foursquare. And today, I'm going to talk about some of the technologies that most fascinate me. So, this is technologies are the future of the brain, our human brain, and where it is headed with technology. So if we examine our brain, we will realize that for over 100,000 years, our brain has remained the same. But the world around us has changed radically. So think about it. We have the same brain as a prehistoric cave person, as a Neanderthals, the same brain. But the world has totally changed. That is the power of our brain. It's very elastic. It can reprogram itself. But now, we're going to begin to change our brains. And we are doing this with new technology. Now, some of the basic technology out there, EEG, allows you to actually measure your brain waves. And these devices can tell if your concentration levels. They can be used to actually move a cursor on a screen. There are applications for these devices in entertainment. They're working on them for controls for games. In medical, these devices are being used for conditions like PTSD, post-traumatic stress disorder, and ADHD, and other conditions. And they're being used for education. They have applications now for children to study, and they measure their concentration levels and can actually change the applications as the children learns. But where we're headed, and let me tell you, one minute, is these devices are now capable of actually recording dreams, but not in a very granular way. In a very primitive way, they can actually capture and identify what a person is dreaming. So they have done studies where they've hooked these devices up to a person's head, they've had them dream, they woke them up, and then they asked them to recall memories in their dreams, and they read the patterns of the brain. And then the person goes back to sleep, and if they dream of the same things, they can recognize those patterns. That is just the beginning of where we are headed. Right now, scientists in laboratories around the world are developing brain chips. Now, these are chips that can be inserted into the brain, and they are wireless. So, they now have, in a laboratory, monkeys with chips in their brain. And then they have an electric wheelchair. And just by thinking, just with the thought of the monkey, they can drive the wheelchair around. Think about that. If a monkey can do that, what could you do if you had that chip in your brain? They have also done experiments with monkeys with a chip in their brain and a robotic arm. And the monkey, just by thinking, can reach out and grab something, like food, and feed itself. That is amazing, if you think about it. So the monkey's thoughts are actually able to control things outside their body. So when we start to think about the future, about where technology is headed, even more interesting, scientists have done experiments with rats, and they have chips in the rat's brain. And what they did was they taught a rat how to do certain things. And when the rat did all these complex things, it could get food. Now, it took the rat weeks to learn that. Weeks. But then they hooked the rat's brain chip to the internet. And they had another rat in another city. And instantly, they connected those two rats' brains. And do you know what happened? The other rat knew how to get the food right away. It didn't have to learn anything. The knowledge was transferred from one brain of a living animal to another brain. That is amazing. That opens up a world of possibilities. Because if they can do that in rats today, imagine 10 years from now what they can do in humans. And we will go there. So, mind-to-mind communication. This is something of science fiction that we all read about. But this is actually possible today, as I just showed you. So there will come a point where if we have a chip in our brain, and you out there have a chip in your brain, we can communicate. We can communicate without talking. We can communicate when you're halfway around the world. And we can exchange knowledge. So, if you look at a world where we have these chips that are connected to the internet, all of a sudden, every piece of information on the internet becomes accessible to our minds. Now, when we look back at today and we have to go to Baidu or Google and type it in, that will seem so primitive. Nobody will do that. You will just think, what knowledge do I need? And it will appear there for you to use. But it gets even weirder, stranger, because we will not only be able to transfer knowledge, but we will be able to transfer memories. Now, so you could have an experience like skydiving, and all of a sudden you could transfer that experience to a friend, and all of a sudden they have experienced what you have experienced. It gets even weirder, because we will be living our lives as our lives. We know our lives and our memories, but you will all of a sudden have access to anybody's life who wants to make it available to you. People will put open source their lives so others can download pieces of their lives and experience those things. That will be really strange. We won't know the difference between our own memory and a memory we acquired from someone else. Think about that. It gets even stranger. So, you, all of us are here learning at Siebes, right? Getting EMBAs and MBAs. Well, this will be obsolete because Siebes will literally be in the cloud and you will just download from all the best minds in the world whatever you need to know when you need to know it. Our brains will be, we will no longer have universities as we have them today. That will change. Information will be on demand. Information will be commoditized. Knowledge will be commoditized. All of us will be smarter, have infinite amounts of storage, and infinite access to information. It will be unheard of. We will no longer be this isolated human being. We will be connected to everything. So, you can imagine not only will we be able to get knowledge, but we can actually have full experiences in our head. So right now we have these clunky VR units that we have to put on. But in the future, you can just download a whole environment and actually live in it. And all of you might think, this is not real. But do you know every night when you dream, those dreams are real. No matter how fantastic your dreams are, they are real. You feel like you're really there. Our brains have that capability already built in. All it takes is the technology to stimulate and transfer the right images in our brain so our brain creates them, and then we will live like the difference between us dreaming and reality will be blurred. We will be spending a lot of time outside our bodies. So, think about this. You, as a human being, right now are trapped in this body. But once you are connected to the internet, you are no longer trapped in your body. You can actually be anywhere at any time that any other person or any other device is getting sensory information. So there could be a robot on Mars, and you could literally tap into the robot on Mars, and it would be like you're on Mars, it could totally recreate the experience, including the sensations, the physical sensations, like everything of you being on Mars. You can live through other people, your favorite pop star, your favorite scientist. You could be in Elon Musk's head right now, walking around doing what he's doing, if Elon Musk allowed you to do that. It gets so strange because our senses now, we have our five senses of our body. But suddenly, if we are connected to a world of intelligent machines and intelligent sensors all over, we will no longer have five senses. We will have access to hundreds of sensory input, infrared, right? All these UV, all these different types of senses that we never even experienced before. It will radically change how we perceive existence. So if you start to go down this path, you see, we won't even be, our life today will be totally alien to us. We will be living in a whole nother reality that is blending information, sensory information, data information, memories, all of this from all around the world in this vast internet. And that will and can happen. So let's go even further. Experiencing other lives. So all of us experience things in our life. But now we will be able to have many lives. You can have many lives because you can access other people in other places and live through them. And if you want to think about this, it can be almost like heaven. Why do I say this? Because if you study every major religion in the world, every religion, Buddhism, Christianity, you know, Hinduism, what those religions promise us is that we will escape our bodies in the future. We will go to some heaven or nirvana or a state of non-being or a state of inclusiveness with everybody. No longer will we and our consciousness be confined to our bodies as an individual. In fact, if you look at us right now as a human being, if I feel pain, if I'm in pain, nobody else can feel the pain I feel. If you're in pain, I can't feel your pain. I can feel sorry for you, I can empathize with you, but I cannot feel your pain. But in this world, we will actually be able to feel the emotions of other people. You can actually not just transfer data and sensory information, but emotions. I would know your pain, you would know our pain, and human beings would never be alone. So, we will come to a point where we as gods, like gods, will be creating our own reality. We will be redefining what the human experience is for the first time in history. This can happen, and it will happen, but what we want to think about is this. Technology is really powerful. The internet, being connected, is really powerful. But we've already seen, in a very primitive way, just with our cell phones, these primitive devices, how it can totally change our life. Like, all of our lives are changed by WeChat. All of our lives are changed by the internet. Well, we are embarking on a path now where we will become the internet. The internet will become us. They will be inseparable. We'll have our storage and everything else all over the place. And when we do that, we have to understand that this is a big responsibility. It's something we as a society, we as the human race, must think about very, very carefully. Because imagine, people can hack your cell phone now. People can hack your computer. And it can be bad. They can steal your banking information, take all your money. They can steal your identity. But they can't really hurt you. In the future, though, if somebody hacks into your head because it's connected to the internet, they can steal you. They could actually steal you. They can implant memories in your head that you don't have. They could erase memories. They could control you in ways that you wouldn't even know you're being controlled. Is this scary? So I painted on the hand a heaven, but there is also a hell, right? This is heaven And hell, we are on the cusp of this technology that is so powerful and has the potential to so radically transform our lives and our existence, and we have to be very careful about how we do this. We don't want people controlling us. So think about this. Think very carefully. Everybody in this room are very smart people. You're all highly educated. We are going to be making these decisions that lay the groundwork for this technology in our lifetime. And those decisions will affect the rest of humanity more than any decisions we have made in the past. So I wanted to thank you. I am the author also of this book, Making Elephants Fly, published by Zhang Xin. And I love China. I travel here all the time looking at new technologies. And I just want to say it has been a pleasure being here. Thank you so much.
You've given out a power away to people who are using it against us. People need to understand. People need to wake up to what's really, really going on before it's too late. And stop looking at the mainstream media. Stop looking at the mainstream newspapers. Start looking at some information that's real and is relevant, because otherwise we're all going to be microchipped. We're all going to be controlled. We can barely do anything now, having to ask the government for permission to protest against the government. Our freedoms are being taken away by the day, and people are not noticing because they're being distracted with other things, from religions, from TVs, from celebrity gossip. We need to be adults about it. We need to open our eyes, and we need to really, really see what's happening. Otherwise, we're going to be in the middle of this new world order, this complete one system of control, and we're all just going to be barcodes. And that's the way it's going. And that is the true reality of the world that we're living in at the moment.
The people stand above the government. The government stand above citizens. And in America, we've taken the term citizen from them, but citizenship was actually created with the abolition of the slave trade. And it was so that slaves could be given the same rights as the free people, but without the same power. So the citizens were always going to be ascribed their rights and responsibilities by the government. And it was so that they could keep a finger on the ex-slaves. You know, whereas that's now been applied to everybody everywhere, and now obviously you have good citizenship classes at school, and citizenship is on the curriculum now. So all this is being not brought in for us, it's been brought in for a couple of generations' time, when it's totally normalised that everyone is a citizen who only has rights and responsibilities because the government gave them to them. And the standing as the people will be long forgotten by them.
The green ethic is basically the communist movement painted green.
The idea of the sustainable development is their common enemy. We have to save the planet, we have to save our natural resources. It is a bureaucrat's dream to control carbon dioxide.
We have the sustainable development type saying, you've emitted enough carbon in your lifetime, it's time for you to leave. And off you go to the euthanasia chambers.
98% of American commuters think other people should ride transit. The reality is the suburbs are growing faster than the cities.
The global green ethic is being proliferated through children. You start with the young. Over the years, we have an adult population that feels the same way. I see.